Hi, welcome everyone to today's Associates Meeting with Sarah Bloom Raskin. She served from March 2014 until January of 2017 as the Deputy Secretary of the U.S. Department of the Treasury. And before that, she was a member of the Federal Reserve's Board of Governors and a member of the Federal Open Market Committee. And I'm I'm thrilled that Sarah is here, not just today, but all week. And the week after next, through a jointly organized visit with the Stanford GSB's Finance and Society's Interdisciplinary Visitors Program. Did I get that right? Where is Anat? So with Anat from Stanford GSB. So Anat, it's been great to work with you. And while Sarah is here, we're very excited that she's going to be connecting with many, many students, including Stanford Economics Association, Stanford in Government, Stanford Women in Business, Stanford Pre-Law Society, and many others. And I've been smiling all day and for the last couple of days, and I've been telling everyone that it's because Sarah's here, but there's another reason too, because I'm a diehard New England Patriots fan, so I'm feeling really good. So the combination of Sarah visiting and the New England Patriots, it is just, things could hardly be better. So in any case, I won't rank those two. But I hope to see many of you back here at SIEPR on February 28th in a few weeks, when we'll be hosting Esther George, the president of the Kansas City Fed. And of course, we're looking forward to having many of you too join us for the Economic Summit on March 10th in about 4.5 weeks. We'll have lots more events in the spring, including Maury Obsfeld, the chief economist at the International Monetary Fund on Monday, April 24th. So I hope you'll be looking for those and much more in the coming weeks. But Stanford is really a very fitting place for Sarah Bloom Raskin to visit so soon after wrapping up her service at the Treasury Department 2.5 weeks ago. As the Treasury's Deputy Secretary during the last few years of the Obama administration, she did many things, including cyber, that we're going to hear about today. But she also focused quite a lot on the macroeconomic impact of student loan borrowing, something that's of particular interest to many of our researchers and many of our students here, along with cybersecurity and how to better protect financial institutions from online invaders. But her responsibilities there were even more wide-ranging. She took a major role in running the Treasury, a department that has a broad mandate to help maintain a strong economy, promote economic growth, create job opportunities, and manage government finances while also making sure that our financial institutions are safe and secure. And it's this last point that Sarah will be focusing on today. She was really a key player in the Obama administration's goal of guarding against online attacks, an issue that was really at the focus of the White House Summit on Cybersecurity and Consumer Protection that happened, I think, exactly 2 years ago today here at Stanford. During her tenure as the second in charge at Treasury, Sarah advocated for the government to work side by side with the private sector in protecting financial institutions from hackers. She became the Deputy Treasury Secretary in March 2014, making her the first woman to ever hold the Treasury's second highest job. And as I said, she was before that on the Fed's the Federal Reserve Board, a member of the Fed Board of Governors, and a member of the Federal Open Market Committee. Prior to being at the Fed, she was the Commissioner of Financial Regulation for the state of Maryland from 2007 to 2010, and she played a big role there in helping the state's financial institutions respond to the financial crisis. And she's worked quite a bit in the private sector as well, serving as the Managing Director of the Promontory Financial Group, General Counsel of Worldwide Retail Exchange, and General Counsel of Columbia Energy Services Corporation. Early in her career, she served as the banking counsel for the U.S. Senate Committee on Banking, Housing, and Urban Affairs. So she's had a very great amount of experience. She received her Bachelor's of Arts in Economics from Amherst College and her JD from Harvard Law School. She is married and has 3 kids, and I can attest that she is also appreciates sporting events, not just, we talked a bit about the Super Bowl, but we also last night had the pleasure of going to a women's basketball game, Stanford women against UCLA, although it didn't go the way we were hoping. It was, but they will get them in March. So with that, I hope that you will join me with a warm welcome to Sarah Bloom Raskin to SIEPR.
Well, thank you, Mark, for that lovely introduction. And let me just say at the outset what a pleasure it is, really, to be here, to have been invited by Stanford as part of your community as part of the Finance and Society program. I should say, my most immediate reaction to being here so soon after the end of my public service really is just to feel liberated. I mean, like, the shackles are off, and to be able to speak candidly, I think, is just an opportunity of a lifetime. So,
there's some other stuff.
Monetary policy.
Yeah.
Things I never talk about. Yeah. When both Mark and Anat approached me while I was still at Treasury about my visit here this month, I have to say I was immediately convinced that with the launching of this Finance and Society series, that they were onto something of significance for this institution. Because ultimately, the point of these academic efforts, indeed, the surpassing importance and purpose of deeper and more analytically rigorous understandings of finance, is to bring these understandings to bear on our conception of societal good. So while it's been somewhat of a fad in the years prior to the financial crisis to pursue finance for its own sake, to approach it as a standalone discipline capable of its own field of study, the financial crisis itself reminded us that the thinking of finance as analogous to something like quantum mechanics was probably a limited way of thinking, and that instead, finance had tentacles into our economies, our neighborhoods, households, businesses, and entrepreneurial communities. And while the fields of finance and economics are worthy of study and mastery, they are only worthy to the extent that we keep our eyes on the prize. The prize being, of course, what the study and mastery of finance means to our society. And the extent to which these finance attributes contribute to a good society. And of course, once we realize that it's the pursuit of some notion of the common good that ultimately gives the field of finance its worth, we also then open ourselves to questions that we maybe hadn't asked before. And this most certainly has been my experience, having traveled the policy world since the onset and during the recovery from the financial crisis. This, again, is the brilliance of what Mark is doing at SIEPRA, what Anat is doing at SBS, and connecting this work in a multidisciplinary way to other faculty perspectives. For once we open ourselves to the possibility, and I would say the necessity, of understanding finance as credibly valued only in relation to its impact on our conception of a common good, we realize that we're rubbing elbows with the data scientists, with the anthropologists, the accountants, the advocates, and indeed the affected entrepreneurs, engineers, families, and policymakers. So indeed, it's this need really to infuse our financial inquiries with societal relevance that was the driving force behind all of the deep dives that I engaged in as our economy moved out of the financial crisis. The connection of our financial understandings with housing and housing market reform, with labor market dynamics, with income and wealth heterogeneity, with student loan debt, with cybersecurity and information security are all connections that I was prompted to fully understand because of the immediate need to improve our economy's trajectory after the crisis. They are each connections that, as Mark said, I'll be exploring with staff, faculty, and students here at SIEPRA, at the business school, at Hoover, at the law school in the month ahead, and to engage in these explorations here with the treasured assets of your academic community is a most extraordinary opportunity. Now, there's always been a lot at stake in these discussions. Today, as the battle cry rises to loosen the guardrails on the financial reforms that were put in place to limit the harms unleashed on our public, the stakes are immediately relevant. This week, with the new administration's call to remove these guardrails, we will have an opportunity to explore directly what the connections are between our pursuits of finance and those of financial stability and security. Again, the timing for these conversations this month could not be more opportune with the richness of relevance. So, this evening's topic is one that I believe this community has particular relevant expertise and perspective on. It's a topic that for me emerged from a recognition of the fragility of the superhighways upon which financial data travels, a fragility that captured my attention, having seen the fragility of our financial sector's ability to deal with securitization of mortgage markets, and what this fragility means in terms of transmission and contagion. The topic, at long last, for this evening, is the risk that cyber hackers present to financial stability and how this risk needs to be confronted. So, the fact of the matter is that cybersecurity incidents are growing exponentially, and the consequences are costly. In terms of the effects of incidents over the last several years, they've included the theft of credit and debit card accounts through retailers like Target and Home Depot. Other incidents have included the exposure of sensitive information on hundreds of millions of individuals who kept information at banks like JP Morgan Chase, health insurers like Anthem and Premera Blue Cross, and government agencies like the U.S. Office of Personnel Management. Information stolen ranges from street and email addresses to medical identification and social security numbers to fingerprints and detailed biographical data. One international crime syndicate allegedly used information stolen from these and other intrusions to manipulate the price of U.S. stocks. We've also seen cyber attacks destroy company systems and wipe out data, such as at Sony Pictures. We've seen money stolen from the Bank of Bangladesh, and we've seen power blackouts triggered through digital means, which last year plunged just under 250,000 Ukrainians into darkness. But as serious as these incidents are individually and collectively, none effectively illustrates the potential catastrophic consequences that cyber incidents can have when they transcend individual institutions and affect our markets and financial systems. This is what we focused on at the U.S. Treasury Department, the effects of cyber attacks on markets and financial systems. So for a glimpse of this type of risk, I'll turn to Mr. Robot, which is a popular U.S. television series. So for those of you who haven't seen the show, Mr. Robot portrays a group of hacktivists operating out of a funhouse in Coney Island, New York. And at the end of the first season, the hacktivists have carried out a massive attack against a large multinational corporation called E-Corp. E-Corp dominates commercial banking worldwide. Through a variety of tactics and techniques, from manipulating employees through social engineering to deploying a zero-day exploit, the hackers break through E-Corp's cyber defenses. They encrypt all the company's data, and they destroy separately stored backup copies of the data. The goal of this destructive attack is to wipe out $400 billion of debt owed to E-Corp, everything from student loans to mortgages. The next day, the global financial system freezes, stock markets plunge, credit card networks halt, ATM withdrawals are capped. Well, you say, surely this can't happen. This is Hollywood, not something based on reality. But I ask you, are scenarios in which the financial system's plumbing gets clogged or breaks down implausible? Haven't we seen this breakdown of financial transmission before? After all, what did the financial crisis teach us about the transmission of contagion? It taught us, among other things, that when the financial system shuts down, liquidity is lost. That illiquidity brings losses to counterparties, which brings losses to the counterparties of the counterparties, and that these losses create losses of confidence, and that when confidence is lost, it's hard to revive. Let's consider the dependence of the financial system on computers, communication networks, and the internet. Now, for much of its history, time and geographical space has bound the financial system. Physically moving money was time-consuming and cumbersome. So in the late 1800s, cash had to be physically moved to the point of the transaction, often by train or horse, and a bank would have to wait to receive the cash before it could use that capital to, for example, make a new loan. But over time, technology diminished the boundaries of time and space. By the 1900s, the Federal Reserve had established book entry transfers and its Fedwire system, which originally sent messages over telegraph lines using Morse code. As the 20th century progressed, computers and communication networks were created, became interconnected, and then ubiquitous as the cost of both fell. Computers, interbank networks, and the internet together increased the speed and geographical reach of financial services. As we shifted from stagecoaches and train cars filled with bills to internet routers transmitting electronic data, our dependence on these transportation modes shifted as well. But the need for confidence in our financial infrastructure remained. Centuries ago, consumers had to place their trust in the horses and the steam engines, you know, that the horse was healthy, that the train tracks were unimpeded, and that the physical movement of cash would not be interrupted by bandits. Today, individuals must place their trust in the internet and its related systems, that they are secure and reliable and protected from illicit intrusions. Consider for a moment an international financial institution that operates commercial and investment banking subsidiaries in the US and abroad. Each day, at a predetermined time, the institution transfers US dollars and other currencies into various payment and settlement systems on behalf of its customers and clients, including depositors, businesses, and other financial firms. As the circulatory system for domestic and international economic activity, these payment and settlement systems provide the mechanisms through which funds and related information flow, which are essential to the daily operations of businesses and governments and the lives of individuals. A blockage in one of these systems means that funds and data that need to move from point A to point B can't do so. The longer and more pervasive the blockage, the worse the incident, the more damage done, some damage which may trigger severe, long-lasting problems. A major payments outage that extends beyond 24 hours to a few days or weeks could degrade the operation of the US financial system and beyond, with only the most critical payments likely being made through manual and other workarounds. As a result, in addition to failing to fund many institutions and counterparties, workers might not receive their paychecks, small business credit lines might freeze, and sales of residential homes could be put on hold, all of which present cascading effects on each other. So, how do we protect financial systems in cyberspace? One way forward combines the development of widely agreed upon peacetime norms by countries with cyber defenses that are based on a common risk-based approach with a robust assurance protocol. So I'll talk about each of these. I'll start with the need for peacetime cyber norms. The internet is human-made and has no geographical boundaries. It was created and has evolved with interoperability and efficiency in mind, not security. As a result, nation states and private parties move freely and easily through cyberspace. Movement is unfettered. unfettered access is good. But how can bad actors be kept out? One way to keep them out is through the establishment of global cyber norms. Now, norms can make the technological frontier more secure by creating some rules of the road. We know, for example, from the modern history of other major technological events, that it takes time for consensus to develop on rules of the road. Remember, after all, it took decades to advance international cooperation on controlling nuclear weapons. And I'd argue that today's need for global security in cyberspace, in many ways, presents a similar inflection point to the early discussions to limit nuclear weapons. Once norms take hold, they provide a powerful force. If fully embedded into our collective thinking about how the world works, they can make it hard to imagine operating in any other way. Now, there are several examples of efforts to create consensus around cyber norms. For example, 2 years ago in Turkey, and then reaffirmed last year in China, the leaders of the group of 20 economies affirmed that international law applies to nation-state conduct in cyberspace and agreed that countries should not use their cyber capabilities to steal trade secrets and other intellectual property to provide a competitive advantage to their commercial sectors. But there are other proposed cyber norms, and you can imagine what these look like. For example, here's one. Countries should not intentionally damage the critical infrastructure of another state or impair the use of critical infrastructure that provides services to the public. Or, here's another one. Countries should not impair national computer response teams from other nations when those teams are responding to cyber incidents. Or, countries should cooperate with requests to other and from other nations to investigate cyber crimes and mitigate malicious cyber activity emanating from their territory. Now, proposed norms like these are a long-term play. We don't have them yet. In the short term, as the scale and sophistication, though, of incidents and attacks continues, a parallel strategy is necessary. And it's a parallel strategy that is capable of success because it relies on the fact that more than 80% of cyber incidents can be prevented. So this parallel strategy is effective for precisely of the reason of this statistic, that more than 80% of cyber incidents can be prevented. The fact is that 80% is a very high number. And we are still then within the realm here of human error. We can fix the vast majority of our system's vulnerabilities to cyber intrusions. Once we realized that this could be done, we set to work to bring that 80% figure down, to encourage the financial sector and the government itself to do some strong defensive work. At first, this is what we did at Treasury, at first the financial sector privately, you know, said it was incapable of understanding cybersecurity. Financial institution CEOs and their C-suites said that addressing the hacks was the province of the IT geeks. And the IT geeks spoke in a language that no one understood. So repeatedly hearing this from the financial sector meant that we needed to devise a common language so that the IT world could explain what was happening to the C-suite world. And the common language we deployed was the language of enterprise-wide risk management. So from our work on the financial crisis, we knew that the financial sector knows what it means to discuss risk. They can discuss credit risk and market risk, operational risk, legal risk, reputational risk. And so once cybersecurity was understood as a risk, by placing it within the so-called banker lexicon and out of the IT lexicon, a common language was created. And progress on this 80% preventable number could begin. So we then realized that what we were doing domestically to chip away at the avoidable hacks could be done also internationally. Again, maintaining that some strategic choice, that strategic choice to engage with the financial sector by using their language. We sought an international work group that would be receptive to putting the cyber risk into a risk management frame. Well, that international work group was the G7 finance ministers. And remarkably, after a series of international meetings this past October, the G7 finance ministers and central bank governors endorsed and published something called the G7 Fundamental Elements of Cybersecurity for the Financial Sector. These fundamental elements have become the basis for a common risk-based approach to cybersecurity for the global financial sector. They're designed to be universally applicable, process-oriented, and dynamic. The elements apply across the financial sector to all types of financial institutions of all sizes, from depository institutions, exchanges, payment systems, to fintech companies and third-party service providers. They're designed to be tailored and proportionate to the particular characteristics of each entity, as well as to the specific cyber risks that entity faces. So through outreach with the financial sector, we learned that boards of directors and senior management are only beginning to step up their oversight of their organization's cybersecurity programs. A recent survey of US banks found that the majority of them only began board-level reporting of cyber risks in the past 3 years. So we wanted to help leaders drive efforts to fortify their entity's cybersecurity and resiliency. As such, these elements call on entities to establish cybersecurity strategies and operating frameworks tailored to their specific cyber risks, and to assign roles and responsibilities within the institution for personnel in charge of implementing, managing, and overseeing those strategies and frameworks. Now, these fundamental elements, they also elevate governance by emphasizing the importance of executive management and corporate boards in setting the cyber risk tolerance for their organizations and overseeing the effectiveness of cybersecurity programs in managing that risk within those established parameters. Cast through the lens of governance and the fiduciary duty of care, the elements empower boards of directors and senior leadership to ask the right questions, hold their teams accountable, and consider the relevant trade-offs before making decisions about their organization's cybersecurity strategy. We also know that in the face of a sophisticated cyber attack, a resilient financial system has to be able to recover quickly, even if certain functions or activities remain offline or operate in some degraded state. Now, achieving resilience depends on private entities and public authorities working together towards a common objective of maintaining financial stability and instilling buoyancy in the system. In that regard, the fundamental elements that the G7 countries have agreed to outline procedures for responding to and recovering from cyber incidents. These procedures recognize the distinct roles played by the private sector, by public authorities, and by regulators, and the intelligence community, and law enforcement. So the elements highlight, really, the necessity of continuously sharing information among these groups on cyber threats, vulnerabilities, and responses before and after incidents. The fundamental elements also recognize that an entity's, indeed a country's, approach to cybersecurity must evolve and mature. Indeed, it never ends. Achieving resilience depends on entities continuously learning from their own experiences and from that of their peers and other entities, as well as from other critical sectors. So the last fundamental element focuses on the need for constant reassessment so as to identify and remediate gaps. This type of continuous learning builds in a dynamic feedback loop where entities systematically reevaluate their cybersecurity strategies and frameworks based on lessons learned as their operational control and threat environments evolve. But when all is said and done, at the same time that peacetime cyber norms are being developed, and at the same time that strong defenses are being embraced, there's still a missing component, and that's self-assurance. Now, self-assurance is part of the next frontier. This has not been done. Without some way to appropriately assure the effectiveness of the design and implementation of the risk-based approach to self-defense and self-help that's contemplated by the G7 fundamental elements, we risk illusory results. So why is assurance so important? Because we need to arm corporate boards, especially those who are not technologists or cybersecurity experts, with a mechanism to thoughtfully assess management's assertions about the design and effectiveness of their organization's cyber defenses. We also need to equip those same leaders so that they can evaluate the completeness and accuracy of their management's description of their cybersecurity programs. Those leaders should also have a means to credibly and understandably communicate related findings to key stakeholders, like investors, counterparties, customers, regulators, and the public. And while recognizing that the G7 fundamental elements call for cyber defenses that are tailored and proportionate to each entity's particular characteristics and cyber risks, to be most powerful, any assurance methodology should strive for comparability. Why? Consistency in the assurance process allows for measuring progress and driving accountability. And it also informs comparisons with peer institutions in the financial sector and potentially across sectors. Comparability also permits market forces to discipline institutions whose defenses aren't up to par. So these are still the early days in developing assurance processes around cybersecurity. And of course, there are key questions here, like what is the optimal approach to cybersecurity assurance and what are the expected levels of assurance? Imagine, though, a world in which all types of entities could convey the effectiveness of their cybersecurity risk management in a standardized, non-technical way that's appropriate to each entity's size and other business characteristics. Think about the power of such assurance. Boards, shareholders, customers, counterparties, and regulators could gauge the relative effectiveness of organizations' cybersecurity and resiliency. In sum, the goal is to enhance the security and safety of our financial transmission mechanisms, giving attention and care and investment to our financial networks as if they were still horses and rail cars carrying money from place to place so that it can be loaned productively and quickly. At their core, the G7 fundamental elements provide a bridge between our present reality of relative insecurity and this future, far more trustworthy cyberspace. The international community agreeing on key cyber norms to protect critical infrastructure like the financial system is one part of this transition. A robust assurance process is another. To reach this more secure future state, we need to be dedicated and methodical. From investing in the creation of more trustworthy systems, to rapidly sharing actionable, reliable cyber threat information, the largest financial institutions have a duty to contribute to the collective security of the international financial system. Small financial sector companies play an important role too. Their networks and systems can serve as entry points for malicious cyber activity that undermine the public's trust. And of course, governments. From finance ministries, central banks, and regulators to law enforcement and security agencies have obligations to help protect their nation's territory, critical infrastructure, and citizenry. Well, we're not in a cyber utopia, but we're not in the dystopia portrayed by Mr. Robot either. A shared lexicon and mutual understanding of cyber risks in the financial sector across countries has emerged together with a common risk-based approach to cyber defense. With imagination and resolve, it is within the realm of collective human effort to enhance the safety and security of our financial transmission mechanisms, our financial system, and our virtual financial lives. Thank you.
Great, thanks, that's great. So I'll ask a question or two and then open it up. My questions will probably be focused on the cyber issue, but Sarah has indicated that she'd be happy to weigh in on financial regulation and what lies ahead and other matters. So I'll leave that to others. But so one actor in this space that you didn't mention much was insurance companies. So many private, large banks, commercial banks, investment banks, purchase insurance to guard against the possible adverse events associated with cyber threats. And so I'm wondering to what extent insurers are an effective contribute to making the sector more resilient. Are they able to reasonably gauge how well an institution's cyber defenses are, and how important a role do they play? If for example, if the government isn't regulating that much, are insurers a key player in this?
So it's an excellent point, and the cyber insurance market is emerging, so it is growing. Clearly, there's a demand for some kind of risk transfer mechanism that insurance typically provides. Currently, with cyber incidents, if an institution has some kind of hack and loss from that hack, they piece together their current insurance policies and see what kind of coverage they can get. It's not very systematic. But what's appealing about cyber insurance is, well, first of all, the ability to transfer some risk, which is, of course, if that can be done and priced effectively, that's a good thing. The second is, if you think about an insurance product, in order to qualify for insurance, you have to be, you have to meet certain underwriting standards. And you can imagine getting a certain price to your coverage if you engage in certain good practices, right? So what I like about, what I conceive of as kind of an optimal, mature cyber insurance market is that it articulates what those good cyber hygiene measures are as a condition to pricing. And that in and of itself forces a kind of good kind of cyber behavior and good cyber defensiveness. So if this market could be developed more fully, and right now, it's difficult because of pricing kinds of considerations, but if it could be developed, I think it would be an excellent private sector market mechanism to mitigate a lot of cyber risk.
But they're not a big factor right now.
Not yet. We did some work at Treasury in terms of convening insurance market participants and hearing kind of what the prospects were for developing a cyber insurance product. And it's moving along, but the pricing is hard because nobody quite knows what the scope of a cyber incident could ultimately be. It's pretty harrowing when you think about what that scope is, and that kind of scares off insurance companies that have to figure out how to price this.
Okay, and then you alluded to this a bit, but if I'm trying to pick a new bank, or a small business is trying to pick what financial institution they're going to use, are there metrics that are developing for consumers and businesses to evaluate how strong bank A versus B versus C is on protecting the sensitive data?
So currently, no. So it is hard to know if you're an investor or a consumer of some sort in an institution, whether that institution has a cyber risk hygiene that you think is appropriate. What I was talking about when I was talking about the assurance process, I think, is an initial way in which we can start to get some disclosure around an institution's cyber profile. But currently, that's not, you know, that we have not developed something like that. You can also think in terms of the banking context, right, like bank exam reports. Like if this were something covered in a bank exam report, could those exam reports pull out some cyber risk features at the institution? But of course, you know, reports are confidential and supervisory information, so they're not made public. But it is probably an important evolution in this work to figure out how you actually publicize some of this. We did some interesting work regarding not really financial institutions, but firms and third parties, because a lot of functions, of course, are outsourced to third parties. And so we were asking ourselves, can we imagine contracts between firms and third parties where the third party presenting a service or product assures its cyber resilience and security? Because of course, if you look at breaches like Target, right? I mean, that breach was caused by, you know, a refrigerator vendor which had a contract with Target. But if that contract actually had reps and warranties in it that went to a cybersecurity kind of resilience, you can imagine private contract becoming a mechanism by which these cyber protections could get enforced. So we did some work with the American Bar Association trying to figure out whether lawyers can construct model contracts that would provide standard kinds of reps and warranties on cyber.
Okay, great. Yeah. So I'm gonna ask one more question, and then I would like the first question when I call on someone to be from a student. So in any case, I know there are a bunch of students who are here, but just this relates to, so we hear a lot about national defense in the US. So we have $600 billion a year that we spend on national defense, and cyber defense would be one small component of that. Do you have a sense of how much the government is deploying, like what sort of resources they're deploying in the cyber defense area? And has that been growing, and is that likely to change in the coming years?
So there are components. What we've been talking about primarily is cyber defense, right? How you actually, if you're a firm, how do you defend your, you know, important data and information? The other piece that I didn't discuss has to do with offensive operations, right? So in the name of national security, launching cyber offensive measures against perpetrators. So that is obviously a piece of a comprehensive cyber security arrangement that, from the perspective of national security, that our country engages in. Now, what the breakdown is in terms of resources, you know, hard to say. But I would argue, by the way, that those sort of cyber offensive tools, they need to be protected as well. So this is kind of the tigers are out of the cage problem, right? Can you imagine if the holder of these cyber tools, say the NSA, actually doesn't take care of the tools and they get in the wrong hands, right? So all the things I've been talking about in terms of protecting information, dealing with third parties, I would argue applies to the government as well.
Okay. Okay, so do we have a student who wants to come up with a question? Let's see. I'm gonna. I saw Andrew first, so I'll ask Andrew. Sorry, George.
Hello. Thank you for coming here. I have a question about algorithmic trading. So a few years ago, there was an incident known as the flash crash, where a malfunction in an algorithm caused several 100 points of stocks to briefly crash before immediately rising back up again. Given that more and more trading is done through algorithms, how would we begin to start quantifying the risks of moving towards algorithmic trading given non-sure cybersecurity?
So it's an excellent question, and you are right that algorithmic trading is having significant effects on market functioning, right? Because these algorithms do have the capacity to create crashes, and we have seen this. And what we typically do when we see them is we analyze them. We try to figure out what is occurring, why did this happen at this precise moment. But I think you're right that there does need to be a collective, and I would argue a public, really, responsibility, I would say by Treasury, to take a look and try to talk about whether these risks of particular forms of trading are creating issues for market functioning. Now, so far, you know, they've been few and far between, but the trend, if you want to call it that, is arguably one that is going to need some significant analysis.
Next question, right here.
Given in the G20 we have two of the worst bad actors in this area, how close or far are we from potentially getting a sign-off and a buy-in from the G20? I don't have to name who they are, everybody knows.
Yeah, so I've been thinking about this because, of course, what I was able to do is get this consensus in the G7, but as you point out, the G7, these are our friends, right? So and they don't include many, if any, of the perpetrators and the hacktivists that have been attacking our systems. So the work, though, and I think it's critical that we expand. Like, in other words, what we did in the G7, I thought that was a huge step forward, and I, you know, had never anticipated that in the tenure, certainly, that I had at Treasury, we'd be able to get as far as the G7. But we have to go much further, because if you look at incidents like what happened to the Bank of Bangladesh, right, it's other regimes that have that are presenting the same kind of risk, and we need to figure out ways in which we bring them into an understanding of what these fundamental elements say. So how do we do that, you know, when some of them are not our friends or may not be our friends for particular reasons? So what I have argued in terms of how we use our discussion of risk management, I would do the same thing. So in other words, I think that what we don't want to do with countries that are not our friends is we certainly don't want to show them our roadmap to actual financial architecture within our firms, right? Because that kind of gives them the playbook for how to attack. But I don't see any reason why we can't have a discussion on sort of from a risk management perspective, talking to them not as national security folks, but as regulators, the same people that we engaged in when we talked to the G7. You know, I can imagine doing that in the context of a bigger group. Now, of course, I'm not there anymore, and it's going to be left to others to make that same assessment. But I know if I had stayed, that would be an attempt, a next step. I don't see any reason why we can't move that dialogue further. And I think we have to. We have to figure out how to do that.
Anant, right here.
Thank you, of course, for coming. You know, I could take in a lot of your words, as well as this discussion now, G7, G20, and all of that, and just straight translate that into the discussion of, you know, capital regulations and debt and all of that. And the issue is just, my question is, are there incentives in the private sectors to do this, given, so you're talking about board, fiduciary, and duty of care, and, you know, insurance markets and all of that. Insurance markets reminds me of CDSs, and duty of care is like, do I care that I'm investing depositors' money and I don't have equity to absorb the losses and I'll have contagion? In other words, I'm not internalizing the externality of my systemic, you know, ripple effects. So it's the same thing. And there, too, we try to regulate and we have agreements, and then we don't have good enough systems. So my question really is, will this ever come from the private sector, or do you really need to regulate that and to kind of bring in the experts from the outside into the system, you know, macroprudential, call it, of this issue?
Right. So, you know, I'd like to see this happen without regulation. I'm not convinced that a regulatory solution is really a solution that is going to be as nimble and as adept as the changing character of these cyber vectors are. But, you know, of course, you raise a good point. Ultimately, though, if there is a debilitating attack at an institution, at a financial institution, and that institution loses consumer data, data is somehow misappropriated, systems are completely destroyed, what do you think happens to that institution's reputation? In the tubes, right? I mean, it's like it's completely wiped out. So to some extent, because of the reputational consequences of what a cyber attack could bring, it's arguably the case that institutions have a self-interest in getting this right.
Next question right up here, and we'll go over here.
So I'll reassure you, Anat, anybody who's worked in a large commercial bank knows how many dollars have been spent in this effort for quite some time. I think I've got some company in this room. Because they're scared as you know what, for exactly what you described. I have a different but related question. Has anybody done any work that you like that shows what really the economic consequences of this are? I try as much as I can to see the productivity enhancement that comes from these expenditures, but as much as I try, mostly what I see are the things in these large organizations that are not being funded that are productivity improvement because the dollars are going to fight this. And what do you think, therefore, this is really doing to us given that productivity is so much of an issue today?
Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I think that you're reacting to a real feature of this kind of defensive work, which is that the costs seem to continuously climb higher and higher. It's like no amount seems to be enough to actually be able to capture the risk and contain it. I would assert that that clearly has been the experience, particularly of the larger financial institutions that are holding a lot of data, and they have taken a big investment lead in terms of protecting systems. What I'd like to think is that we're going to enter into another phase where those costs can become contained. And that's why I'm talking about now and what I think needs to get focused on is some kind of assurance process so that we don't get into this cycle where we're just completely spending without any cap at all, because we essentially have to keep protecting ourselves. I think also that we need to do an assessment of what kind of costs are associated with which kind of breaches. So what typically now is occurring is that firms are evaluating their so-called high-value assets, right? So they're saying, this set of assets, if there were a breach here, this would be catastrophic. But this set of assets, actually, they don't really present the same kind of risk. And so then the design efforts and the investment efforts get focused on those high-value assets. So we do need to enter a stage where we start prioritizing the value of different assets so that we're not essentially doing like major spending for every category when we don't really need to. I mean, there are some assets that you might be able to tolerate a breach or some kind of breakdown in systems for a while. And then there's others that, this is our treasure chest and we are gonna make sure it is completely guarded. So I think that kind of prioritization is something that should be able to start to be more helpful.
I'm gonna try to squeeze in. Okay, we got one more, then we got one back there, and hopefully.
So out here we get a lot of good understanding of the problem through Yahoo's had a big problem, number of consumer sites. Do you have examples where hundreds of millions of dollars have been lost by financial institutions in the United States in the last recent years? And kind of what kind of wake-up call that's had for the system, similar to what 9/11 did for us in the Islamic terrorism. What is that? What are all the bank CEOs? What is the thing that that's kind of waking them up that you can use to actually move things forward, maybe a little faster?
Yeah, no, it's a great observation. The financial sector has been ahead, I think, of other sectors. So if you look at the critical infrastructures, you look at the financial superhighways, you look at telecom, and you look at energy, right? So the power set, the sort of the power grid is one critical infrastructure. The telecom, which is of course the communication networks, and then the financial piece. In terms of the work I described, the financial sector is way, way, way ahead, okay? And so that, I think, has been, you know, that's been a good thing. But to get this completely right, you know, you could have a breakdown in, you know, you could have a breach at a power plant, which could have the same kind of rippling effects. And just because the financial sector has invested all this money in protection doesn't mean that they're going to be able to deal with what has happened in another critical infrastructure. So the work I'm describing, I think, has to happen among all critical infrastructure pieces. In terms of a wake-up call, in terms of our U.S. financial sector, we have not had misappropriation of financial data. Nobody has woken up, people haven't woken up on a massive scale, like logged into their, you know, their account information and seen, whoa, zero, 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 I have nothing left. Like, that has not occurred yet. But it's within the realm of possibility, and it's what these investments and what these institutions are so fearful of happening.
Can we get in one more? Sure. So we've got a student. We started with a student question. Let's try to finish with a student question. I'm sorry to.
Yeah, okay. I have two questions. One very short one. First of all, are you concerned more by the threats posed by rogue actors or state actors in terms of cyber attacks? And then secondly, correct me if I'm wrong, but I assume that companies like Apple and Google have a better record in terms of protecting consumer information. I mean, I think it's safe to say most people in this room trust Apple with a lot of very private information. Do you think the government could levy Silicon Valley and its expertise in cybersecurity and protecting consumer information to help inform how the financial sector protects its own consumer information? And then, in addition to the fact that Silicon Valley anyways has an interest in having a stable financial market because, you know, they participate in capitalism.
Right. So very quickly, so your first question on distinguishing actors, we do that. Obviously, we do that from a national security perspective and from an enforcement perspective. So anytime there is an attack, we want to know who did the attack so we can take enforcement action. So yes, we make distinctions. In terms of what I talked about today, in terms of basic defensiveness, it kind of doesn't matter who the attacker is. But from an enforcement perspective, which I would argue is an important piece of this, because of course we have to change the cost calculation. We have to make it more costly for individuals or state actors to launch attacks. The enforcement piece is very important. In terms of your second question, I actually can't comment. I have no particular visibility on some of the tech companies here, the big ones, in terms of what their practices are in terms of protecting PII, what we call PII. I think probably their records speak for themselves in terms of what has been what has happened. So I actually can't speak. I don't have that knowledge in terms of leveraging those technologies to work with the government. We in the government always brought in as many experts as we could, and frankly we learn a lot from each breach that occurs. And I would argue that the private sector itself has learned from seeing different kinds of breaches in the public sector as well. So those kinds of examples should always be front of mind, and we should be doing forensic work on each one so that your own institutions are protected.
Okay, great. Well, we should wrap up there. So thanks very much to Sarah.
Thank you.